Well, we've already found out Jerry Chesnut's got a great sense of humor. Of course, we all knew that from many years back. But he's also got a whole lot of hit songs in his catalog. I bet we could talk you into doing one.
That's good for business, isn't it?
Huh?
That's good for business.
We were talking about Farron Young a while ago. Seeley was talking about him. How did you get your great song, Four in the Morning, to Farron?
To Farron? Farron never, you know, I never did pitch songs. You came to my office looking for a hit. Everybody came to me for a hit. Never a B-side or album cut. They're looking for a hit. And once I started having hits, everybody would come running wanting a hit song. And back then, when you record, you look for hit songs. Now they got co-ops and so forth that cut stuff or write stuff, you know. And I think that's what it is. It's the BMI Awards the other night, and the one thing I can't figure out is how you've got two writers and six publishers. I'm serious. I can see two publishers and six writers, but I don't understand six publishers and two writers, but that's really happening a lot. Let me say first of all, when I was growing up, I never dreamed of being a songwriter. And I had a friend in Harlan County, Kentucky, this is, and my brother got a Sears Roebuck guitar for Christmas. And they told me, whatever you do, you don't touch that. That's when I decided to be a guitar player. And anyway, I wound up playing guitar and wanting to be a star. This buddy of mine had a record of Zeke Clements and one of Eddie Arnold, and we played them day and night. I wound up inducting Zeke Clements into the Hall of Fame and going to lunch with Eddie Arnold every other day. Years and years later, after wars and everything, you know. But when I was overseas during the Korean War, every time we'd land on these little islands, I'd put a band together. And even on the way over on the troop ships, I entertained troops and played a banjo. I'd tune it up like the last four strings on a guitar and play it. And but anyway, when I got back from overseas, while I was there, every night I'd get on the stage, they wanted to hear Wild Side of Life. And I thought, what if you wrote a song like that and Hank Thompson or somebody would record it and play it on the radio? Wonder what it would cost. Anyway, I got this crazy idea of maybe...
It cost about $500,000.
Writing a song. So I loved Filipino Baby. Bacopas, you remember?
Yeah.
And so I decided to write the Filipino Waltz. And I wrote, this guy has come back to America, and he's coming back to you across the ocean blue, and I need another line. I said, hair of gold and eyes of blue. A Filipino with blonde hair and blue eyes, that didn't work. So that was the end of my songwriting. Then I went to Florida, and I'd play on weekends and radio and stuff, and I came to Nashville to be a star and play guitar. And I rented a house about a block from Hank Garland. And I'd go over there and play guitar with him, and I figured out my guitar playing wasn't going to work. And then I talked to Webb Pierce about recording, and he said, son, we don't need no stars. What we need is somebody to write hits for the stars we've got. So I started trying to write songs, and 10 years later, I started getting songs cut, and everybody started coming to me, and it's just been a roller coaster. I just had something that, after 30 years after his death, I had 5 songs released by Elvis, but I just had a song the other day that I'd give up on, put out as an instrumental on Elvis Presley. You believe that? He cut a track and the voices and everything and had it all ready to go on The Wonders You Perform. And never got his voice on it. He died. And now after 30 years, they just put it on the end of a CD, instrumental, The Wonders You Perform.
Wow.
Mm. Is that crazy? So songs never die. Great songs don't. And
that is a great song, The Wonders You Perform. Oh, wow.
Incredible song. Yeah. Do a little bit of Four in the Morning.
All right. It's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the wanting in me, wishing I'd never met her, knowing if I'd forget her, how much better off she would be. The longer I hold on, the longer this goes on, the harder that it's gonna be. But it's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the wanting in me. I never deserved her, God knows when I hurt her, that's the last thing that I want to do. She tries, but she can't tell how she feels, but I know too well what she's going through. And if I love her so much, I don't know why I can't do the right thing and just let her be. But it's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the morning in me. Last night I told her, this time it's all over, making 10 times I've told her goodbye. Last night we broke up, this morning I woke up, and for the 10th time I'm changing my mind. I saw more love in her eyes when I left her than most foolish men will ever see. And it's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the morning in me. It's 4 in the morning, and once more the dawning just woke up the morning.
I've got to ask you what time of day you wrote that.
I got up at 4 in the morning and looked at my watch and said it's 4 in the morning and started writing, and I got 2 verses done. There's a good, Felice Bryant told me, more good songs are ruined by people trying to finish them.
Yeah.
For a certain thing or just to get them done, you know. She said, it has to grow. It has to get better. The second verse has to be stronger than the last. And so I had the verse and the chorus and couldn't get nothing else that was doing anything for me. So I got on a tractor and started running a disc up on the hill. And when you're driving or something like that, you kind of get a rhythm going. And I wrote that last verse on that tractor. I keep singing it over and over, and this boy was with me. And all at once, I just pulled a pin on this disc and took off trying to get it down. Went down the hill, and he's hollering, "Where are you going?" And I run in the house, and one of the kids or something said, "Is everything all right?" I said, "Everything's fine." And I run in that writing room and got it down. And then you asked me about Fern. I went to the office that day, and at 10 o'clock then, Fern called, and he said, "Hey, I need a hit." And he did it. He never cut without calling me, I don't think. And so I went over to Mercury, and I sang him a song called "If It Feels Good, Do It." And I thought it was just great for him. And he said, "No, I'll get Dudley to cut that. He'll cut you a hit on that." But he said, "That ain't what I'm looking for." He said, "Have you wrote anything else?" And I said, "Yeah, but it's not for you." And he said, "What the hell you mean it's not for me? You know how Fern just blew." And I said, "Well, it's a waltz. And waltzes sell million records. Every million seller has been a waltz. And you have to go to England and all over the world. You become an international star." And another thing is, I don't think artists like people dancing when they're singing. And so he said, "Well, let me hear it." So anyway, I played him it, about like I did just now. And he said, "I'll get it out of that waltz time." So he got it out of the waltz time. He tried it. I went over Friday when he did it. And he tried it in 4/4. He tried it in Western Swing. He tried it blue. He tried everything in the world. Nothing. Finally, he said, "Hell, let's just do it the way it is." One take went on the next song. He told Hilda later, he said, "If I'd have known that was going to be such a big hit, I could have done it a lot better." She said, "Yeah, you could have run it." But, and Dudley did cut the other song, and it's top 10. Last one he had, I think.
You're sitting next